Good morning. The members of Faith Lutheran Church welcome you to the 8 a.m. broadcast of our worship service from Faith Ministry Center Sanctuary. Today is Christmas Day worship. Leading the liturgy this morning is Reverend Adam Bridgman. Preaching this morning is Reverend Dan Thews. We join the service already in progress.
Well, Merry Christmas, everyone. Last night we celebrated the birth of Jesus, and now we're celebrating that God in the flesh is alive and living among us as we await his second return. And though he promises us eternity, he blesses us each day with every great thing that happens in our lives. And that's sometimes harder to see through the pain that we suffer in this life, in this broken and sinful life. But we always have reason to hope, always have reason to have joy. And that's what celebrating Christmas is all about. So let's begin with our Advent wreath lighting. And our first reading here from Isaiah 62. Pass through the gates. Prepare the way for the people. Build up the highway. Remove the stones. Raise a banner for the nations. The Lord has made proclamation to the ends of the earth. Say to the daughter of Zion, see, your Savior comes. See, his reward is with him, and his recompense accompanies him. They will be called the holy people, the redeemed of the Lord, and you will be called sought after, the city no longer deserted. In Isaiah 9, the peace candle is lit. The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of the shadow of death, a light has dawned. For unto us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. The joy candle is lit. From Isaiah 55, for my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, declares the Lord. As the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. You will go out in joy and be led forth in peace. The mountains and hills will burst into song before you, and all the trees of the field will clap their hands. Instead of the thorn bush will grow the juniper, and instead of briars, the myrtle will grow. This will be for the Lord's renown, for an everlasting sign that will endure forever. The love candle is lit, Isaiah 25. On this mountain, the Lord Almighty will prepare a feast of rich food for all peoples, a banquet of aged wine, the best of meats, and the finest of wines. On this mountain, he will destroy the shroud that enfolds all peoples, the sheet that covers all nations. He will swallow up death forever. The sovereign Lord will wipe away the tears from all faces. He will remove the people's disgrace from all the earth. The Lord has spoken.
Our opening hymn this morning is from Lutheran Service Book 343. Prepare the Royal Highway. Prepare the Royal Highway. The King of Kings is near. Let every hill and valley a level road appear. Then greet the King of Glory, foretold in sacred story. The refrain is, Hosanna to the Lord, for he fulfills God's word.
Now I invite you, as you are able, to rise as we make our confession in this Christmas creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, who sent his only Son as my Savior on Christmas Day. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, announced by the angels, worshipped by the shepherds, adored by the wise men, who lived to suffer, die, and rise again, to free us from sin, death, and the power of the devil. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, who has brought me to faith in the Christ of Christmas, and whose continuous work in my heart, I am ever led to lay before the feet of Christ the treasures of my life, and live under him as my King, both now and forevermore. Amen. And our first Christmas gospel comes from Luke chapter 2. In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world. This was the first census that took place while Quirinius was governor of Syria. And everyone went to their own town to register. So Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and line of David. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in cloths and placed him in a manger because there was no room for them in the inn.
Our next hymn comes from Lutheran Service Book 364, Away in a Manger. Away in a manger, no crib for a bed. The little Lord Jesus laid down his sweet head. The stars in the bright sky looked down where he lay. The little Lord Jesus asleep on the hay.
Continue in the second chapter of Luke. And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all the people. Today, in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger." Suddenly, a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth, peace to those on whom his favor rests."
Our next hymn is from Lutheran Service Book 368, "Angels We Have Heard on High." Angels we have heard on high, sweetly singing o'er the plains, and the mountains in reply, echoing their joyous strain.
Continue in the second chapter of Luke. When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about." So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby who was lying in the manger. When they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told to them about this child. And all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. But Mary treasured up these things and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned glorifying and praising God for all the things they had heard and seen, which were just as they had been told. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Please be seated. In the city of David, a Savior is born.
He is Christ.
God's word does not return empty. It accomplishes what he desires and achieves the purpose for which he sends it. On this Christmas day, we light the Christ candle and remember God's promise is fulfilled in a manger in Bethlehem. In his great mercy, Almighty God has given us an inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade. In the city of David, a Savior is born. He is Christ the Lord.
The next hymn comes from Lutheran Service Book 391. Rejoice, rejoice this happy morn. Rejoice, rejoice this happy morn. a Savior unto us is born. The Christ, the Lord of glory, his lowly birth in Bethlehem. The angels from on high proclaim and sing redemption's story. My soul extol God's great favor. Bless him ever for salvation. Give him praise and adoration.
Grace, mercy, and peace be unto you from God our Father and from the Christmas Christ. Merry Christmas, everyone.
Merry Christmas.
And a special welcome to those of you who are listening with us on radio today. No matter where you are part of our family on this Christmas morn, and a Merry Christmas to you as well. Well, friends, as we work through this great message, as we today on Christmas Day just stop to ponder as Mary did and treasure up these things in our hearts, I want to think about what is the real meaning of Christmas. I mean, think of all the music that was written, that has been sung about Christmas, all of the movies, all of the poetry, all of the fine sentiment and Christmas cards that we share with one another. So much has been said about Christmas. But what is it really all about? What's the message of Christmas? Well, if you ask me, and I tried to sum it up to as best as I could, to me, the real message of Christmas is this: you matter to God. Everything else sort of surrounds this great truth that you are so important to God, that you, not the world, not the multitude, not the millions in this world, but you matter to God. So much so that he would give his only son for you. That God would give up being God in heaven to come into this world and to take upon human flesh and to suffer in this world all that you and I suffer in the brokenness of sin that we experience every day. And he did it all for you. How will we ever be able to wrap our minds around that truth? That we have a God, the creator of the universe and everything in it, who cares about you. What's the message of Christmas? You matter to God. If you pulled out your outline that you have of the sermon message, you can see that's the first line, right? What's the Christmas message? You can fill in that blank. You matter to God. And because you matter to God, he has something very special to give you this Christmas. You know, Christmas is a time of gift giving, isn't it? Gifts is something that we think about at Christmas and something that we do at Christmas. We gift to one another. You know, we've set records this year. I don't know if you've seen any of the statistics online or anything like that, but gifts that have been purchased online this year have set a whole new record. We love to give gifts, and it's gotten even easier, hasn't it? Because now we can order our gifts online. But I'm wondering if all of your gifts got here on time. Anybody still waiting for a gift? My wife bought something from China I'm not sure we're ever going to see. You know, the sweetest lady I know on her Facebook page posted a big old Grinch face, and she just grinched the whole time about something that she was really waiting to get here, didn't arrive yet in time for Christmas. I think there's probably a lot of us that will get some gifts a few days after Christmas. Maybe that's not a bad thing, right? Celebrate Christmas a little longer. I'm wondering, in your gift giving or gift receiving, have you ever received a gift inside of a gift? I read this week about a lady whose husband gave her a set of gloves for Christmas. And when she opened up the package, she saw the gloves and she slipped her hand inside the gloves, and much to her surprise, in each one of the fingers was a little piece of jewelry. Gag. It's guys like that that ruin it for the rest of us that thought a bowling ball would be a good Christmas gift. I don't know why Kelly didn't like her bowling ball. But here's the point. When you get the Christmas gift of Jesus, when you realize that God loved you so much, that you matter to Him so much, that He gave His one and only Son for you, not only do you get the gift of Jesus, but you get a gift within a gift. Along with Jesus, the greatest gift, come also these beautiful gifts that God gives to us for all of life. We're going to talk about three of those amazing gifts that God gives to us. The gift inside of a gift of Jesus. And I want to use the words of the angel. On the top of your outline, you see from Luke chapter 2. The angel said, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is Christ the Lord. Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to those on whom His favor rests." In the words of the angel, you see the three gifts that God gives to you this Christmas, the gift inside of Jesus. We'll talk about, if you're feeling in your outline, God gives us the gift of joy, God gives us the gift of hope, and God gives us the gift of peace. Let's talk first about the gift of joy. The angel said, "I bring you news of great joy." Another translation that I love says, "I bring you the most joyful news ever announced." What a great task that angel had when God said, "Here's what I want you to say. I want you to go to the world, and I want you to tell them that this is the best news, the most joyful news, that this is the most incredible news that has been, will be, ever announced." Joy. The angel says, "I want you to be joyful." Would you smile a little bit right now, everybody? Joyful. God is not some cosmic killjoy in the sky, standing up there to hit you with some bad news, waiting to make your life miserable. You know, a lot of people think that faith and boredom just go together. A lot of churches start at 8 o'clock sharp and end at 9 o'clock dull. They're just boring. And we get this misperception of God that He doesn't want you to smile. And if you smile, you're in a lot of trouble. Can you imagine? What if one of my girls, my sweet daughters, came up to me and said, "Daddy, I love you. I want to be the kind of girl you want me to be. I want to have a beautiful relationship with you, Dad. I want to do what's right." What do you think I would say to my daughter? Do you think I'd say, "I've been waiting for this day. You say you want to do right. You say you want to do good. You say you want to hang out with me. Well, here's what's going to happen. You're going to go sit in the corner and do math problems all day. You're going to eat spinach every meal. And I'm going to break all your toys. And if you smile, I'm going to wash your mouth out with soap." Would I ever? Never. But a lot of people think that way about God. They think, if I really come to God and say, "God, I want to be what you want me to be. I want to be a believer. I want to follow you. I want to do what you want me to do. I want to have a beautiful relationship with you, Lord." They're afraid that God's going to say, "Well, okay, now here's what I'm going to do. You're going to have to give up everything you love. You're going to have to sacrifice everything that's important to you. I'm going to make your life miserable, and you're going to have to be a monk or a nun." That's not what God says. He says, "I've been waiting for this day. I've been waiting to give you the joy that I have in you, in life, the joy I want you to experience in life." God wants us to be in that relationship with Him, to love Him, and live in the joy of that relationship. Some people think Christian means miserable. It's not the truth. It means joyful. I will never forget a time at the gym. A guy I had known for a long time finally found out that I was a pastor. And he said to me, "You're a pastor? How come you're always so happy?" I'm like, "What? Christians aren't supposed to be happy?" But that's the perception sometimes in the world. The angel showed up that first Christmas and said, "I bring you news of great joy." Joy. This is the gift of Christmas. That no matter what is going on in our world, no matter what is going on in our lives, we can always have joy because that joy is a gift from God giving us in Jesus. Amen? Second great gift is the gift of hope. The angel said, "Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you." A Savior has been given to you. Someone who saves you. That's what Savior means, right? One of my favorite Christmas cards this year said, "If our greatest need had been information, God would have sent us an educator. If our greatest need had been technology, God would have sent us a scientist. If our greatest need had been money, God would have sent us an economist. If our greatest need had been pleasure, God would have sent us an entertainer. But our greatest need was forgiveness. So God sent us a Savior." God gave us a Savior. And what does it mean that we have a Savior, one who saves us? Look at your outline. A Savior means forgiveness for our past. No matter what you've done, no matter what mistakes you've made in your past, you are forgiven because God sent you a Savior. No matter how unworthy you might feel, you are worthy because God gave you a Savior. Do you see? Forgiveness for our past. And because we have a Savior, it means we have freedom to live meaningful lives now. We are free to not have to worry about pleasing God. We're free of not worrying that we've done enough to get God's favor. We're free to live a life knowing that we are loved and forgiven, knowing that we have joyful purpose in our lives. Forgiveness of our past, freedom to live meaningful lives in the present, and fulfillment for all eternity. Because we have a Savior, we know heaven is our home. We have that place waiting for us where there'll be no more sorrow or sadness or weeping or gnashing of teeth, but rejoicing in the good news of Christmas. Look at the verse I printed from Jesus' words, John 3:17, the bottom of your outline. God did not send His Son into the world to condemn it, but what? To save it. To save it. You and I have a Savior, and because we have a Savior, we have hope. We've learned we don't have to do it ourselves because God has done it for us. You know, back when I was in college, I had to take a lifeguard class. If you've ever watched a lifeguard when someone is drowning, you know that they'll swim right up to the person and they'll just get about 2 feet away and tread water. They won't immediately grab onto someone who's drowning because the person is usually flailing around, moving their hands in every direction, and if they try and save them, they'll pull them both under the water. So the lifeguard will just wait until the person tires themselves out and starts to go under. And when they finally give up, that's when the lifeguard will grab them around the chest and swim them to safety. And that's the way it works with God. As long as you're trying to save yourself, God can't save you. As long as you're thinking, "I've got this. I got this figured out. I'm not so bad. I can solve all my problems. I can figure out my own plans. I don't really need God. I don't need it. I'm my own boss." God says, "All right, you just try that and see how it works. Give me a call when you need something," right? God says, "You want to try it that way? Go for it." But we know it doesn't work. All we get when we try and do that is frustrated and stressed and angry and worried and guilt-filled and bitter and depressed. It's not till we give up and hear the words that we have been given a Savior that we realize that we are saved. And because of that, we have hope. It doesn't depend on us. It depends on our amazing God. So what's the gift in a gift? It's the gift of joy. It's the gift of hope. And if you flip your outline, the third is the Christmas gift of peace. The angel said, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth, peace to those on whom his favor rests." Did you know that God wants you to have not just a good relationship with him, but also a good relationship with people? Did you know that was his plan? That we live together in love and kindness and goodness? Did you know that God wants us to forgive one another? That God wants us to be good to one another and serve one another? Sometimes we forget. We sort of say, these people are worthy of grace and goodness, these people aren't. That's not the gift that God gives us at Christmas, of choosing whom we want to love and choosing whom we want to forgive. But God's gift of peace is for all people. He says, "I want to have a right relationship with me so that you can have a right relationship with others." Look at it in your outline, point B. This is the way I think it works. First, you get peace with God. And then once you've got peace with God, then you get the peace of God in your life. And then once you have the peace of God in your life, then you can have peace with other people. So listen, here's a Christmas gift today for you from God. Peace with others. Now you might be saying, as I wrote here, "Pastor, you just don't know what they did to me. I could never forgive them. I could never love them." And that's why we need Christmas. Because human forgiveness and human love always run out. But God's love never runs out. There is an endless supply of his love for you. And that love for you enables you to love others, even those that don't deserve it. Even relationships that have been broken for years, God's love is bigger, and God's love reconciles, and God's love heals, and God's love works through you to bring peace. God wants you to have peace in your relationships with your family, with your friends, with those you work with. And God gives you the ability, his love, through you to love others. So to conclude today, the Christmas gift, you matter to God, and because of that, he gave you Jesus. And along with Jesus, you get joy, you get hope, and you get peace. Now, are you ready to open up God's Christmas gifts for you this year and bring them into the year 2024? I read about a guy who's trying to break the world record for the longest unopened Christmas gift. He wants to be in the Guinness World Record book for this gift that he has now had for 43 years that's been unopened. Is that the silliest thing you ever heard of in your life? I mean, if you gave me a gift and then came over to my house like 6 months later and it was sitting there in the corner unopened, and you said, "What?" And I said, "Well, I really loved your gift. I just haven't had time to open it yet." What would you think? God today has given you an amazing gift. The gift of Jesus Christ. And along with that gift comes joy and comes hope and comes peace. Will you open it? Will you open it and let him give you that gift for the upcoming year? I pray your 2024 is filled with God's gift of joy, hope, and peace. God bless you this Christmas and always. Amen. Well, now let's say thank you to God for the gifts that he has given us as we give back to him our own gifts, our offerings. As the ushers come forward with the baskets, I want to thank you for your giving. You know, these are the gifts we use to lift up the name of Jesus Christ, to share the Christmas joy with our world. So thank you for your giving.
Our offering hymn this morning comes from Lutheran Service Book 387, Joy to the World. Joy to the World, the Lord is come. Let earth receive her king. Let every heart prepare his emblem room, and heaven and nature sing.
And as you're able, I invite you to rise. Let us pray. Gracious Father, in the birth of Jesus, you have given your greatest gift to us.
With these our Christmas offerings, we give ourselves to you in humble service and ask of your help to follow where Christ has led the way.
Amen.
We bow our heads to speak to God in prayer. Gracious Lord, Heavenly Father, this Christmas we shout with the angels, joy to the world. We are so grateful that we matter to you so much that you would give your only Son for us, that we might not just know that you love us, but see it in the proof of a little baby born and laid in a manger. We are so grateful that this baby came into our world not to be served, but to serve and lay down his life for us, that we might be forgiven and spend eternity with you. Lord, let the rest of our lives be a chance to witness and share the love that we feel for you and the love that you have for others. Lord, we pray that you would bless those at this time of the year who are sick or hurting. We pray that you would bless them with doctors and nurses and medicine, technology, healing from your hand, that they may be well, and that you would give them love that they need at this time more than ever. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
And Lord, we pray for those who struggle with the grief of losing a loved one. At this time of year, Christmas, there's just so many memories, and it can be a very painful time. And so, Lord, in the grief of loss, we pray you would give the hope of everlasting life won for their loved ones by Christ, that they might know without a shadow of a doubt that their loved one is at your side in heaven singing the most beautiful Christmas carols ever. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
And Lord, we pray for our church as we celebrate our 75th anniversary this year at Faith, that you would continue to bless us with pews full of worshipers, volunteers serving, and people going out into their neighborhoods with the good news that unto us is born a Savior. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
These and all other prayers we bring to you in the name of Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen.
Amen.
And now we prepare to receive the sacrament of the Lord's Supper. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise. As we draw near to the newborn Christ child on this sacred day, we quickly realize that we are not worthy to behold God himself taking flesh as one of us, yet the birth of this little baby testifies to God's great love for us.
Holy God, we confess that we are not worthy of your gift of the Christ child. We have not loved you with our whole heart, nor have we loved others as ourselves. We have often lived in selfishness, ignoring the needs of others. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of Jesus, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and live out our lives as children of the light. Amen.
To us, a child is born. To us, a son is given. The angel said, "You shall call him Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins." Because of Jesus, his birth, death, and resurrection, and by his command and in his stead, I forgive you your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit.
Thanks be to God. Amen.
Blessed are you, O Lord, for you have had mercy on us and given your only begotten Son, Jesus, as a ransom for many, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. At this altar of mercy and love, let us now unwrap your gifts of grace and experience the true presence of the Christ child as we rejoice in the forgiveness of our sins and your gift of eternal life.
Amen. Amen.
And we're bold to pray as Jesus taught us, our Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come.
Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. May the Lord look upon you with favor and give you his peace. Go in peace and joy and share the good news.
Thanks be to God.
Our closing hymn this morning is from Lutheran Service Book 388, Go Tell It on the Mountain. The refrain is, "Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is born."
Thank you.
We thank you today for joining us for our Christmas Day worship service. All the members of Faith Lutheran Church invite you to join us for any of our worship services. We would enjoy sharing the time with you. For Ministry Center locations, worship and education times, please visit our website at www.faithboxvalley.org or call the church office at 920-739-9191. Any communications regarding this broadcast can be directed to Stephen Moore, Director of Worship of Arts, Faith Lutheran Church, 601 East Glendale Avenue, Appleton, Wisconsin, 54911. Until we meet again, please share the gifts of joy, hope, and peace. Merry Christmas. God bless and peace be with you.